Grand morning, grand morning. Hello to everyone, and to everyone, a grand morning. Hello, hello, everyone. Lakeisha McKnight is here. Welcome to a brand new Monday. That's right, a Monday. Monday, January 20th of 2020. It's time for the virtual Bible study. Happy MLK Day for those who celebrate the remembrance of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. as well. And so I know Facebook is letting many of you know that we are live. If you hear a little bit of a ding noise throughout this, of course, excuse it. It's notifications on social media on another platform, which I have yet to figure out how to turn off. All right. I actually do. Let's see here. I may try to turn it off this way. Let's see if I can turn it off this way. I'll just do that and it should work. Perfect. Yeah, should work. All right. So again, welcome and good morning to everybody as you're here on the platform with me. And so we're live on Spreaker, iHeartRadio as well. We're also live at the leadershiptkostation.com. And so what we're going to do is, as I normally do, I conduct a watch party so that more and more people can hear the message about the kingdom of God. And so I'm going to do that. I am going to share and actually start a watch party in a group. It's a group comprised predominantly of women. And the Bible study is for both men and women, by the way. So it's not specifically for women alone. So you're more than welcome to share this out if you like. Okay, be a blessing to those who are connected to you. And I'm going to dive into that in just a second. But I just wanted to put it out early as I am doing that myself and preparing the way. So locating the group, and then I'm going to start it. I'm also going to make sure that the audio is pretty good as well.
You share this out if you like.
Okay, so sounds pretty good to me. Let's greet the ladies of the group there. Good morning, ladies. Okay. Perfect. Okay, so for those who are live, those who may catch the replay, good morning to each and every one of you. And of course, as I was sharing, happy MLK Day for those of you who acknowledge, you know, this special day given to the late Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., right? And so I can talk all day about him, and I might do that a little bit later on a separate stream. However, for right now, focusing in on the Word of God. So again, welcome everybody. So we do this Monday through Saturdays around 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for the purposes of really helping you to win, teaching you how to win from the inside, inside out. Because a lot of times we of course we do things, we want to walk in our gifts, and you know the focus is externally, right? But we really need to focus on, you know, working on our hearts and our minds and making sure it's in a condition that pleases God. Ultimately, you know, one of the mantras that I live by every single day is, you know, just living to please God. Bam, that is the phrase, that's the motto, living to please God. If it's not pleasing God, is it something that I should do? Right? Is it something that I need to be doing right now? And this is something that we all need to live by, especially for those who are believers, right? Because we are the body of Christ. We are His body in the earth. And so that's what I really want you to think about as we're going forward with this virtual Bible study. So again, welcome, welcome, welcome. And so what we're going to do, I'm going to share with you a couple of ways of how to get involved with the virtual Bible study. And the ways that you all can get involved with the virtual Bible study, number one, you can love the stream. Love the stream. If you believe and you love the Word of God, love the stream. Hit the love button. Number two, we do have the comments feature, so you can leave your thoughts. You can share your questions, your comments, anything that resonates with you during this Bible study. You can share that in the comments area. And then lastly, number three, we have the beautiful, beautiful share button. I love that button because we can reach more and more people. You know, you can hit that button and we can do watch parties from, you know, from my stream on my timeline, and even just sharing out the watch party for those of you who are plugged into the watch party itself inside of the group. We can reach more people with the good news message, period. And that's one of the things that I believe we're all called to do, okay? Making disciples, sharing the gospel message, right? So we can do it all together, you know, hand in hand, arm in arm, right? And so, again, welcome aboard, everyone. And so what we're going to do, I'm going to give a little bit of an overview of what to expect for those who are new, because we've been doing this for some time. We've been doing this for over a year. So for those who are new to the virtual Bible study, what we do when we come on here is we go over a couple of these, you know, nuggets as far as what to expect. And then we're going to be praying. We want to make sure that our hearts and our minds are good ground for the word. After prayer, we're going to be reading scripture. So today we're looking at Luke chapter 6, verses 1 through 26. Again, Luke chapter 6, verses 1 through 26. After reading, we're going to assess what encouraged Luke to include these verses in his gospel account. We'll also talk about how to apply these verses to our lives. How do we make it practical? Because you can read it all day, and of course you have to read it in context, but how do we make it real for us? How do we apply it to our lives today? So we'll talk about that. We'll summarize what we have read, and then we will pray so that we can be dismissed. So that is what we normally do and what we cover during this short time that we're together. And normally it's about a half hour for those who are wondering. Okay, it's about a half hour that we're here together. All right. So once again, share it out. Love the stream. Let's go. We are about to pray. Here we go. Let's pray. So Father in heaven, Lord, we say thank you so very much for this brand new day, God. This is a day that you have made and we will rejoice and give thanks. That's right. We're going to be glad in it, Father. We thank you so much for the rest you've given us last night, early this morning, the activity of our limbs, God. We thank you for allowing us to be in our right minds, to be able to open up our mouths to say thank you. Thank you. There are some people who may not have made it, but by your grace and your mercies, brand new today, God, you saw fit for us to be here. We say thank you. We thank you for that, God. And so we take a moment to realize that and recognize that you are King of Kings. You're Lord of Lords, the great I Am, that bright and morning star. You are our peace. You are our provider. You are our healer. You are everything that we need you to be and more. We can't even wrap our hands and wrap our minds around all of who you are because you're so good. You're so good, God. And so, Father, even in this moment, we're thanking you for the technology given so that we can come together like this. We're just asking that you would forgive us of all sin. Cleanse our hearts, Lord, and our minds of everything that is not of you, every transgression, every iniquity. God, wash us and purify us of every sin, God. And even as we're before your throne this morning, we're just asking that as we open up the word, that you would give us understanding, knowledge, wisdom. Transform us by the renewing of our minds, that we would prove what is that good, what is that perfect, what is that acceptable will of yours. And so, Father, we thank you. We love you. We just ask that your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right, once again, we are here about to plug into this word. Luke chapter 6, verses 1 through 26 is where we're going to be. All right, Luke 6. Now, if you're curious, I am reading from the New King James Version Bible. Mine may look a little bit on the raggedy side. It's because I can't give up this Bible. Okay. All right. I love this. I love this Bible here. We got a history. We got a history. All right. So again, Luke 6, 1 through 26. All right, let's read. Now it happened on the second Sabbath, after the first, that he went through the grain fields, and his disciples plucked the heads of grain and ate them, rubbing them in their hands. And some of the Pharisees said to them, "Why are you doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath?" But Jesus, answering them, said, "Have you not even read this, what David did when he was hungry, he and those who were with him? How he went into the house of God, took and ate the showbread, and also gave some to those with him, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat. And he said to them, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath. Now it happened on another Sabbath also that he entered the synagogue and taught, and a man was there whose right hand was withered. So the scribes and the Pharisees watched him closely, whether he would heal on the Sabbath, that they might find an accusation against him. But he knew their thoughts, and said to the man who had the withered hand, arise and stand here. And he arose and stood. Then Jesus said to them, I will ask you one thing. Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or to destroy? And when he had looked around at them all, he said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he did so, and his hand was restored as whole as the other. But they were filled with rage and discussed with one another what they might do to Jesus. Now it came to pass in those days that he went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called his disciples to himself, and from them he chose 12 whom he also named apostles. Simon, whom he also named Peter, and Andrew his brother, James and John, Philip and Bartholomew, Matthew and Thomas, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon called the Zealot, Judas, the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who also became a traitor. And he came down with them and stood on a level place with the crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to hear him and be healed of their diseases, as well as those who were tormented with unclean spirits. And they were healed. And the whole multitude sought to touch him, for power went out from him and healed them all. Then he lifted up his eyes towards his disciples and said, blessed are you poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you shall be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you shall laugh. Blessed are you when man hates you, and when they exclude you, and revile you, and cast out your name as evil, for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward is great in heaven. For in like manner their fathers did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full, for you shall hunger. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. Amen. Amen and amen. There is so much in these verses that we have read this morning. It's a lot. And I know we have a short period of time. But what I am going to do is we're going to definitely touch on a few things. I encourage you to definitely go back, read this entire thing, of course, yourself, so that you can grab even more from this. All right. So let's start from where we started off, which is verse number one. We started at verse number one. And so for these first couple of verses here, it's important that we understand. It's not just that this was recorded here in this gospel account, but I know Matthew speaks of this and Mark speaks of this particular situation as well. It was the second Sabbath, right? And he went through the grain fields, the disciples being with him, they begin to pluck heads of grain and eat them. Okay, rubbing them in their hands. And the Pharisees, of course, points this out and asks the question, you know, why are you doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath to do? Okay, not lawful. And of course, if you go back to Matthew, I believe it was Matthew chapter 12, Okay. And it's really good to cross-reference and go back to the other gospel accounts simply because you get a full view as to some of the things that are actually taught in these chapters here. See, the point of the matter, even in this section, is, you know, actually, you know, there's no law really prohibiting the plucking of grain in order to eat on the Sabbath. Because gleaning handfuls of grain from a neighbor's field to satisfy your immediate hunger was permitted. Okay, was permitted. Now, what was prohibited was really labor. Okay, labor for the sake of profit. That's what was prohibited. Now, a farmer could not harvest, for example, for profit on the Sabbath, but an individual could glean just enough grain to eat if necessary. Okay, if necessary. And so that's the point. Okay, that is the whole point. And the biggest point that I believe Jesus makes, you know, even when speaking to, you know, the leaders about this day, the Sabbath, you know, the whole thing is this, that Christ has the prerogative to really rule over not only man-made, you know, Sabbatarian rules, but also over the Sabbath itself. The Sabbath was designed for worshiping God, okay? It was designed for worshiping God, not to put, not to create even more bondage for man. It was created, you know, for people to worship God. But unfortunately, the religious leaders, they, you know, the thing is with those who are highly religious, they create, you know, their own rules and regulations that holds men to be bound. So they can't walk in the liberty and the freedom that God gives them. Okay. And so that's not what God has called. You know, and it's so important for us to understand that, you know, we don't have to try to add more. And that's what God specifically says. You know, we're not to add more than what he's already given. Okay. And unfortunately, man believes that, you know, you got to complicate things. You got to just overdo certain things, right? Do what he says to do according to the word of God. That's the most important thing. All right. Not adding anything to it, not taking anything from it, but doing what he has given, fulfilling what he has given. That is the focus. Okay. And even after explaining all of this to the Pharisees and the religious leaders, you know, on another Sabbath, he went into the synagogue and he began to teach. Okay. There was a man with a withered hand, right? Scribes and Pharisees watching to see how they can accuse him. Isn't that like those who are high and mighty, those who are religious minded, those who believe that they are higher than thou, to try to point some flaw or some concern out to find accusation? And that's exactly what they were doing, right? But here's what happened in verse 8. He knew their thoughts and said to the man who had the withered hand, arise and stand here. Okay? He asks one thing. Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or destroy it? He looked around, right? Said to the man, and nobody said anything. Okay, nobody answered the question. So he said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he did so. His hand was restored, just like the other one. And we see their reaction, right? Filled with rage, right? They discussed amongst one another what they might do to Jesus. Okay, so a curious response in the face of so glorious a miracle. They were filled with rage. Okay, they were unable to answer his reasoning. So by healing the man only with a command, he had performed no actual quote unquote work that they could actually charge him. Okay, so they couldn't find a reason to accuse him. So their response was just anger. That's what their response was. They couldn't find a reason. They really couldn't. All right. And then, of course, the following section, even furthermore, a couple days went past. And we noticed one thing that Jesus continues to do. We got to look at some of the things that he did. We got to do what he does. What did he do? Now, we don't have to exactly go to a mountain to pray. Okay. You can go to your own prayer closet. You can go anywhere. You can pray anywhere. As long as it's, of course, appropriate, you can actually pray to yourself, you can pray outwardly, but you don't want to make a show of things, okay? But we notice some of the things that Jesus has done. He went out to the mountain to pray and continued in prayer all night, it says, to God. right? So take some time. And I just think that this is good here because it just reminds us that prayer is essential. Okay, prayer is essential. And again, that's communication with God, two-way conversation. But in most cases, we really need to do more listening than talking. Okay, more listening than talking. And it says, when it was day, he called his disciples to himself. And notice, of course, you know, these men here that is chosen, you know, were predestined. Okay, predestined. A part of the ultimate plan. A part of Jesus' circle to carry out our earthly ministry. And there's going to be some people whom God has, actually, there are some people whom God has connected to you, predestined. You may not know all of them. But he will begin to recognize those individuals who is supposed to be a part of, you know, I don't want to say your circle, but connected to you in fulfilling certain assignments on earth. And so you'll begin to see that. And I realize that there are certain people who are going to be with you for a season. You got those seasonal individuals, and then you got those individuals who are going to be with you for an extended duration of time. Okay. For various purposes. And look, it's not the case that all people who are connected to you or may come into your life are connected to you for what you believe to be a great reason. But ultimately, it's to fulfill the assignment that God has upon your life. Because if we look at verse 16, it actually says Judas, the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who also became a traitor. So that was his assignment. That was his assignment. God knew. You know, what he was going to do. Okay. And that was his assignment. That's something that he did. He fulfilled it. Okay. Unfortunately, his life came to an end. And I believe everybody has a decision that they can make as to whether they want to choose, you know, to believe God and to do what is right. But, you know, in his case, as we learn, he didn't do that. Okay. And so, after choosing these men, you know, to be a part of his circle, he came down, stood on a level place, and, you know, there was a lot of people nearby, and many people came to hear him speak, and he began to heal, you know, the people of their diseases as well. Okay, and what I love about this is that, you know, they knew, they believed, and they have faith, because what did it say? You know, in verse 19, the whole multitude sought to touch him. Okay, so to even to touch him, they knew that they can be healed. It says, for the power went out from him and healed them all. Healed them all. It's powerful. Just powerful, guys. And even we see, which is common again throughout all the gospel accounts, these Beatitudes, right? They call it the Beatitudes, right? From verses 20 through 26. And you can go actually specifically in the gospel account of Matthew, we'll see it. So Matthew and Luke has this. And in Matthew, if you want to go back to Matthew, it's actually Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. Okay. The significance behind this is that this gives us an account of, you know, really how we ought to live. How we ought to live. You know, the demeanor, the posture, the attitude, the spiritual attitude that we ought to have, right? When it comes to living this life. And we see that here, you know, blessed are the poor, blessed are you who hunger now, for you shall be filled. Hungering, you know, to really seek to please God, hungering to receive more of God, more of what God has for you spiritually, wanting to connect with him even more, right? But it also gives an account of for those who may struggle to enter the kingdom of God. Okay, those who believe that they have it all, right? Who cannot, in a sense, cannot be given more because they have it all, when it says, but woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Rich, not necessarily, doesn't necessarily mean financially rich, okay? Because remember, those who are poor, there is lack, there is a void. Right? There's something there's a need present, a huge need present. But those who are rich have it all. They have no need of anything. You know, he said he came to really heal those who are sick, right? Those who are sick. And it can be that, you know, they're in need of spiritual renewal. There's a void there. Okay, there's a strong need, a replacement, meaning God, an area where only God can fill that particular area. Only God can manifest healing in a person's life who lacks, for example, a relationship, a divine relationship with Him. Only He can fill the void, and that void is present for everyone who doesn't have a relationship with Him. Okay, but for those who has that attitude, that mindset, and are blind to the truth that they need a relationship with Him, this is what He deems as far. They have all material things. They may have a whole lot of things in their lives, but they're lacking that one thing, and that is the relationship with God. And then when He says, woe to you, in verse 25, woe to you who are full, for you shall hunger. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. All of it is essentially connected to the one thought, that they have no need, that they're blind of the truth, and they have no need for a relationship with God. Okay? And so it's important for us to realize this, even as leaders. It doesn't matter, you know, what your walk of life is, what your background is. Every single man that has breath needs to have a relationship with God. Period. All right? Period. It doesn't matter how much material wealth you have. It doesn't matter, you know, whether, you know, you're born into a family with an inheritance or one that doesn't have much of anything. Every man, every living thing that has breath, every person, I should say, that has breath, right, needs to have a relationship with God. Okay, that's one and huge point that I got from reading this entire section. And of course, living a life that pleases Him. Okay, living a life that pleases Him. And another thing too is understanding that God created, you know, remember, if you go back to creation, go back to Genesis, remember, it's not that these things were made to rule over us and to be lorded over us. We were created, you know, all these things were created to be a blessing for us, right? Because He created the earth and everything in it, and then He created man afterwards. He's like, okay, well, after I set the scene, after I put everything in place, I want to be able to allow my creation, right? Him and her created in His image to enjoy, to dominate, to rule, to have dominion, right? So He set the tone. So it wasn't that all these things were created to be lorded over us, to really hold us bound, but that we may freely go about and do what it is He's called us to do, which is to have dominion. And notice, it wasn't that we're supposed to have dominion over people. He told us to have dominion over the land and the animals and all these things. But yet, we do a little extra. We are a little bit extra. And we want to add a whole lot of things to it. And that's not what He wanted. That's not what He wanted. We got to stick to the original plan we were supposed to, right? And so there's a lot of work, and this is why, you know, we as a people, we need a lot of prayer. We have to pray for one another, pray for our government leaders, pray for, of course, everyone, even those in the military, everyone. Okay. Because again, if we were to go back to Genesis, we would be all right. We would be all right in truly understanding how we ought to live. All right. And I'm hoping that you've gleaned a lot from what it is that we've gone over today. Definitely go back over, you know, this particular section yourself. Even the prior section in Luke chapter 5, it gives you an understanding and context of how to put all this together, all right? And then understanding how does it apply to our lives today. Got to make it practical, which is what we've tried to do today. So whatever it is that you've gleaned today, whatever nugget you've received, I want you to share that, if possible, in the comment section. Okay, in the comment section, we'd love to hear your thoughts. And even if you have questions, you can share it there as well. And so it's a beautiful thing. I appreciate you coming together with me on the platform here. What we're going to do right now is we're about to pray so that we can be dismissed. Let us pray. So Father in heaven, Lord, we say thank you so very much. We thank you for this time you've given us, number one, to come together, to connect with other believers, and even allowing everyone who's tuning in to be inspired, to be encouraged, to learn more about, you know, your will. And so God, even as we are together, I pray that, Father, that we would just stick to your plan, that we would not try to add extra to it, but that we would stick to your word and just live and carry out your word by the leading of your precious spirit. We know that we can't do it in and of ourselves, but with your guidance and with your direction, we know that we can live a life that pleases you. And so, Father, help us to grow to become the women and even the men for those who are here that you've called us to be. We just pray, Father God, that you will continue to do a work through us. The lives out there that need to be touched, that need to hear the message of the good news of the kingdom of God. Father, may you give us the words we ought to say when sharing it with them. Give us boldness, give us courage to be able to go out there and share the good news message. We know that it is you that worketh through us. So let it be less of us and more of you. And so, God, we thank you so very much for all that you've done. We thank you for everything that you will do. We thank you for the dreams, the goals that you've given us, God. We thank you for the life and the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And we just pray, Father, that his dream will continue to live on, that we would be able to walk and carry out your will, your purpose, your perfect plan in our lives, the dreams that you've given us. For we know it's not necessarily for us, but it's for the blessings of others, to be a blessing for more and more people out there. And so, God, we thank you. We love you. We pray for new doors to be opened. We pray, Father God, for relationships to be restored today. Marital relationships, daughter and mother relationships, son and father relationships. But we just ultimately pray that someone today would ask, what must they do to be saved? And according to your word, Father, you said, if we believe with our hearts and confess with our mouths the Lord Jesus, that they too, we all, can be saved. And so, Father, we thank you. We love you. And we just ask that your perfect will be done. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for tuning in today. Be a blessing to somebody else today. Show them that you love them, right? Show them that you love them. And as you already know, I love you. And God loves you all the more. Be blessed, everyone, and have an amazing day.